I'd like to share with you what some people consider a highly controversial document in model train operations and my solutions in using this document on my layout. If you'd like to follow along as I go through this document, I have provided a downloadable link down below so you can download this document for yourself. Don't forget to click or tap the like, subscribe, and ring that little bell so you do not miss any other content on this channel. So I'll meet you over at the desk and we'll get started. What I have here in my hands is NMRA Recommended Practice RP-20.1 Revised January 1990 Car Weights. Let's have a look at this controversial document and see how we can improve operations on our model railroad by following the practices listed in this document. The way we can look at this document is a very well thought out document that can stand the test of time or a document that should be updated to modern times. I'd like to point out a couple things on this document. You'll see a revision of January 1990, which would make this document almost 30 years old. If you look at the bottom, there's another revision in 1998, making this document 20 years old. We have two ways to look at this document. It's either very well thought out and can stand the test of time, or it should be updated with the way we do operations now. There are three main items on this document which make it a well thought out tool for operations on your layout, so I'm going to go over those really quickly. The very first statement is very important to this document. Carefully documented tests show a decided advantage in performance past obstructions in the tracks for cars weighted to an optimal weight. Since the radial forces tending to cause derailments are greater in longer cars, the optimal weight will vary with car length. So that's a pretty interesting statement. It's something to think about, and that's kind of the key factor to this document. We'll go on to the next statement. To find the optimal weight of a given car, enter the table below in the desired scale and find the initial weight. Then find the additional weight and multiply this by the number of actual inches in the length of the particular car body. Add this weight to the initial weight for the total optimal weight of the car. That statement might sound like a basic word problem from junior high, but it's a key component to understanding the table below. The final part of this document making it so important is the table down below. This table is broken down into several key parts. You have scale in the first column, initial weight in ounces in the second column, a simple addition in the third column, and the additional weight per inch of car body length in ounces in the fourth column. That table right there is the heart of this document and is the most important part of the document to understand. We're going to start with an HO scale boxcar. What would be the final recommended weight of a 4-inch long HO scale boxcar? Now it's time to help me learn something. Tell me what your answer is in the comments down below. From the beginning of model railroading till today, the weights of cars have varied from scratch building to different manufacturers, making a document like the RP-20.1 weight standards by the NMRA a very valuable asset in your toolkit. I'd like to give you my take on the NMRA weight standard document and how I use it in N-scale. This is my interpretation of RP-20.1 NMRA recommended practices for car weights. This is what I call my N-scale NMRA car weight calculator. The first thing you'll probably notice is the red and white stripes. Each red and white stripe is 1/4 inch. As listed here on the side. From the length in inches, if we move in, you'll notice the equivalent of that length in inches in N-scale feet. For an example, 3 inches equals 40 N-scale feet. Next to that number, you'll find the minimum weight recommended for that car in grams and ounces. Working with N-scale, NMRA does recommend using ounces. I prefer to use grams just to get a more accurate read. As you'll notice, 0.7, 0.7, 0.7, 0.8, 0.8, 0.8 ounces, they repeat. We get a tighter tolerance with the grams in N-scale. Before I can put my interpretation of the NMRA weight calculator to use, I need to have a scale. I've selected a basic scale from your typical office supply store that reads in ounces and grams. Some key features on the scale, and I recommend it for any scale, is a scale has ounces and grams. I'll be using grams. It also has a tear function. The scale is now on. I'm going to select it to grams. To check the function of the scale, I have a weight that weighs 66 grams. I'll drop it on the scale and I have 66 grams. One of the key features on this scale is the tear button. So we'll hit the tear button here, and what it does is it recalculates the loading on the scale and will zero itself out with that weight on the scale. So I can actually drop another 66 ounce weight onto that scale and I can read that as 66 ounces. I can remove this weight and it actually zeroes itself again. If I remove this weight, it breaks the tear. I'll have to reset the tear on the scale, or I can turn the scale off and then on again and it'll recalibrate back to zero. Why is tear such an important function on that scale? Yes, my calculator is on just a piece of paper and it doesn't make that big a difference. But at a later point, I'm actually going to put this in a section of plexiglass and seal it so it doesn't get damaged during use. What I need to know is when I first put it on the scale that the scale is actually zeroed. So we'll move it to grams because that's what I'm dealing with, and I'll hit tear and it is zero. In fact, if I remove my weight, hit tear again, actually I'll move my paper, when I lay my calculator on the scale it actually weighs 7 grams. If I have it encased in plexiglass it will even weigh more. So the object of the tear button is to zero the scale out for when I make my measurement. So right now the scale is zero to what's on the scale bed itself. Now if I put my car on here, I should get 66 ounces. That way I can get an accurate reading for my NMRA car weight calculator when I actually do weigh my cars. One of the final components to getting the best use out of your calculator is a simple notepad and a pencil. To use my car weight calculator, it's really easy. I place the end of the car on the black line at the bottom. I go up the scale and find out where it hits last, and it shows it should be 28 grams. Let's flip it over to grams. So what it shows me here, this car weighs 22 grams, so this is light. So what I'll do is I'll document this car, which is GNC5835. It weighs 22 grams, so I need to add weight till it weighs 28 grams. So I've documented that car. We'll pull out a different car, and this is just to show the variations of them. This car's recommended weight is 38 grams. It is extremely light. SSAM38711, and we're at 22 grams and it needs to be 38 grams. So this car is extremely light. I'll repeat the simple process as I weigh each car. If a car is equal or slightly above the NMRA recommended weight practices, I can put the car back in the layout. I'll document on the car card itself that the car checks good. If it is low, I'll continually add it to my list as a fixed item. If it's way above, I'll also add it to the list because it will need to be fixed too with the weight reduction. As you do this, you'll come across some really strange oddities. For instance, these cars are relatively identical, but they do not weigh the same. We'll start with the first car. We'll lay it on the scale and notice it weighs 11 grams, well below the recommended 25 grams. So I'll have to add more weight to this car after I document. This car, if you lay it on the scale, you notice it's in at 29 grams. So somebody has added weight to this at one point. It's actually a few grams over, so it's not enough to affect the operation of this car. In fact, when you open up the top of this car, somebody's added bullets as weight for this car. I have two other cars that I'll be checking. Both of them are auto racks. One by Concord, one by Microtrains. I can tell that they weigh different. Same type of car, different manufacturers, different weights. I'll start with the Concord car and we'll stick it on the scale and it should be 43 grams. We're at 40 grams and it should be 43, so it's almost right on target. Just a little bit of tweaking, that should be ready to go. Now we'll try the Microtrains. It weighs 63 grams. It should be around 43 grams. You do end up with a couple surprises. I was thinking the Concord car was actually light. It's actually closer to the recommended weight than the Microtrains car. But still, the weight on the Microtrains car is not so far out that I'm gonna have to remove weight. I'm gonna leave it as is. I just completed weighing all my cars. I found out 6 of the cars are underweight. 1 car is recommended weight and 2 cars are overweight. The overweight cars are not that far off to require me to remove the weight, but I definitely need to add weight to the 6 underweight cars. I'd like to know your opinion on this document, so let me know down below. Is it still well thought out theory, or does it need to be updated for modern times? I've selected two great videos for you, so click or tap right there, or click or tap right there, or find those two buttons down below. And as always, stay frosty, my friends.